Hello everyone, let us understand the role of oxygen therapy in COVID-19 patients. Oxygen therapy by definition says administration of oxygen at a concentration greater than the environment, that is about 21%. Oxygen is used as a therapy in managing many illnesses. When it comes to COVID-19, 15% of the individuals with COVID-19 develop moderate to severe disease, which requires hospitalization and oxygen support. A further 5% patients require admission to ICU and a supportive therapy including intubation and ventilation. WHO recommends supplementation of oxygen has to be done immediately in patients who have respiratory distress, hypoxemia or a shock with a target of saturation or SpO2 of 90 to 94%. This is a beautiful chart which gives us a clear idea how should we go about giving oxygen therapy to COVID-19 patients. When we see a mild case where the saturation is between 90 to 91%, then we can even start oxygen therapy in the ward itself with a nasal prongs or a face mask. If the patient improves with this, we can discharge them from the ward itself. If patient does not improve in your saturation level or with the other conditions, they can escalate the oxygen therapy with high frequency nasal oxygen or a non-invasive technique. As the chart says, if the patient improves, they can be discharged, or depending on the other conditions, patient can be thought of giving intubation or a mechanical ventilation or just a palliative care. But there is one very, very important here is rescue therapy. The latest study shows that prone positioning for 16 to 18 hours per day results in very much improvement in saturation of the patients. This rescue therapy should be adapted even in mild cases to severe cases. Now let us see what are the devices available to give a oxygen therapy in the world. Coming to the oxygen therapy in the world. As we see all in the picture, the nasal prongs, the name itself suggests it has a cannula with the two prongs which can be fitted into the nasal larynx of the patient. And this can be connected to the oxygen source. This is a simple, safe, can be shaped to fit to any type of phase. It is well tolerated by the patient because patient can talk, patient can eat, even holding the oxygen nasal prongs. The only disadvantage is it can cause mucosal irritation and trauma. Here in this, the low flow, we can keep up to 1 to 6 liters of oxygen. It will deliver an oxygen of 24 to 31% of FiO2. The next one is, as we all see in this, is face mask or called Hudson oxygen mask. It is commonly used in all the ICU wards. This has got a two side ports, which is not so clearly you can say here. This will help the patient to allow the room air to entrainment. Room air goes inside the patient and exits from the patient. This is connected to the oxygen port. The advantage is this is lightweight, transparent. Even patient vomits, we can see. The disadvantage is the fitting to the face sometimes becomes difficult. You know, if the face is small, the size becomes big, it does not give a proper fit and the patient will not receive the adequate concentration of oxygen. Here again, we can give up to 1 to 6 liters per minute of oxygen. The FiO2 will be slightly higher than nasal prongs here. It is up to 24 to 35%. Coming to the other devices which can be used in the ward. Nowadays, all of us have heard about non-rebreathing mask in all the ICUs or the COVID patients. That is the third one. This is a face mask with a reservoir bag, which is commonly called as non-rebreathing mask. There is a face mask here and a reservoir bag is here. And it has got three unidirectional valves, one on each side of the face mask, which allows the exhaled air to go out and prevents the outside air to come inside. So we give a higher concentration of oxygen because of this unidirectional valve in the mask. There is one more unidirectional valve at the valve to the bag, which prevents the exhaled air to go inside the bag, this bag. So the advantage is here we can give a higher concentration of oxygen and the only thing we have to take precaution, we should make sure this bag is always filled. so that the bag does not collapse. Here we can use up to 10 to 15 liters of oxygen per minute, which achieves a FiO2 of 60 to 80%. So the biggest advantage is we can give a higher concentration of oxygen without intubation. The another mask which we are seeing here is a Venturi mask. This is again a low flow mask. Here they adapt a Bernoulli principle. Here the Bernoulli principle is adapted. The oxygen goes through a small constraint air and it takes the air from the outside so that the larger flow rate is delivered to the patients. The size of the constriction determines the rate of the flow in each of the gas flow. It is all color coded. As we can see here, each one is color coded and the different colors have a different ray flow rate, and it is mentioned in the mask the how much each color code delivers the oxygen and what percentage of the oxygen FiO2 is delivered to the patients. As the name itself suggests, it is from 2 to 12 liters we can deliver per minute. FiO2 can range from 24 to 60 depending on the which mask is used for the patients. Coming to the acute respiratory failure. As this chart is very clearly mentioned, in a case of normal or a mild case, we see a respiratory rate is slightly increased between 20 to 30 and no accessory muscles are into action. We can make out that patient is not in so much of distress because accessory muscles are not in action. Rate is only very, very mildly increased. There is no change in mental status. PaCO2, that is carbon dioxide level, is not increased. We can just admit the patient to ward and start giving oxygen of 2 to 4 liters per minute. The next one would be moderate respiratory failure. Here we can see the respiratory rate is slightly increased than the normal, that is little more than 30, and we can see the accessory muscles of the respirations are in action. That is, you can see here the sternocleidomastoid, alanisei enlarging, all that we can see here, but still we don't see the change in the mental. Patient is stable, oriented, well oriented, conscious, and there is PaCO2 is increased here to 50 to 60 millimeters of mercury. So in such cases we admit the patient to high dependency unit or a ICU. We can start off oxygen with 6 to 8 liters with all our low flow devices, and then patient can be kept in under observation. The third would be a severe acute respiratory failure. Here the rate has gone up beyond 30 and all the accessory muscles are in action. Patient is delirious, distressed, semi-conscious, and PaCO2 has shot up to more than 60, and then we admit the patient to HDU, that is high dependency unit, or a ICU, and then we deliver the oxygen of 10 to 15 liters per minute. So with all our techniques of low flow oxygen concentration, if patient continues to be hypoxic, what is our next plan of action? So patient is breathing spontaneously but not maintaining saturation, then we should think of using high flow nasal oxygen. High flow nasal oxygen is a heated humidified high flow therapy. It is mainly popularly known as high flow nasal oxygen, and it's a type of respiratory support. It delivers a high flow of oxygen to the patient through the nasal cannula. The gas is heated up here to match the human body and temperature, and it is humidified to targeting a human body, targeting the clear body saturation vapor pressure. This is used when patient is breathing spontaneously when other flow techniques are failed. The flow is adjusted to the advantage being here we are giving high FiO2, that is high inspired concentration of oxygen, without intubation. Heated humidification of respiratory gas facilitates the secretion clearance and decreases the bronchial hyper response to the symptoms. So here we keep the rate of 30 liters per minute to 70 liters per minute. And if this worsens, in even the patient worsens with high flow nasal oxygen, then we can go to non-invasive ventilation, that is BiPAP. As we see in the picture, patient is breathing spontaneously And as I already told you, other oxygen delivery devices have failed to maintain the saturation. So we have gone for a high flow nasal oxygen. The flow rate is between 30 liters per minute to 70 per minute. If this also fails to improve the oxygenation of the patient, we have another option of is called non-invasive ventilation, that is BiPAP. BiPAP is a non-invasive ventilation. As the name itself suggests, it is bi-level positive airway pressure. This is a pressure support. This is very, very simple to use and which requires minimum training. It has got a nice fitting mask which has got a lot of straps which can be fitted properly onto the face of the patient. It has got a two levels of pressure is given to the patient. One is IPAP, that is inspirational pressure, so that the inspiration is achieved at a higher pressure, that is between 8 to 20 centimeters of water depending on the patient requirement. And an EPAP, expiration, between 5 to 12, so that there is a easy, comfortable expiration also. Okay, it is supported by the pressure. This will help to improve the saturation, and it is comfortable as and when patient does not require, we can remove the mask and give the oxygen through the low flow for some time, and again it can be fitted to the patient. When all our methods fail, we come to the invasive method of maintaining the saturation, trying to improve the saturation, that is endotracheal intubation. Endotracheal intubation is our last resort where we fail to improve the oxygenation with all our low flow, high flow, as well as non-invasive ventilation. That is when there is respiratory failure, a decreased level of consciousness, extensive pulmonary involvement, then we take a laryngoscope and intubate with the endotracheal tube and connect the patient to the ventilator for further management. Thank you all for your patience listening.